Greetings. All right. My name is Mark Wollen. I do Ex Machina. I do some CRM too. And I've been doing it pretty much most of my career, like dating back to, 27 years ago, I think. So it's been a long time. So like, I've done a lot of CRM. I've worked with a lot of CRMs. I've built a lot of CRMs. I've sold a lot of CRMs. I've implemented a lot of CRMs. Everybody in here have a CRM? Yeah? Like, how many CRMs have you had? Yeah, four? You've had four? Oh, you're gonna give me a good race here. Anybody else? You've had three? And you've only had one. You're very fortunate. Okay. So there's a lot of CRM knowledge in here. There's probably like some bruised knuckles in here. So that kind of wisdom, hard earned, is actually good. I just want to level set here from the beginning as I share with you a little bit more about what we're doing here with CRM in terms of C3 AI CRM, what it is, what it's not, and I think why it's actually pretty meaningful with respect to everything that you've already implemented for your current CRM in your environment, whether it's your first or, lucky you, sir, your fourth. Now, of course, when we think about CRM, it is the gamut of basically how you operationalize engaging with your customers around sales and service and marketing. But a lot of, and this certainly has been my experience, a lot of where CRM journeys begin is around companies being able to get a better handle on and more consistency with regard to driving revenue for their business. I know when I started in CRM with Tom a long time ago, you know, Salesforce automation was the beginning point, and getting that forecast nailed at Cisco and other customers early on was like the foundational use case. And a lot of things otherwise cascaded from there. And you know, and this is, I think, still true today. You see companies basically using CRM to drive, you know, better forecasting. You know, they see it using to manage their reps. And of course, the idea behind this, hopefully, is that it results in winning more deals. And it certainly can, it often does. And companies certainly, like, you're probably in the lead, sir, having four CRMs. Companies invest a lot in CRM to do this. Like over the last 30 years, you know, almost $70 billion in total. And here's the rub, and this one I've been on both sides of in a couple of different dimensions, both as a builder of CRM and CRM adjacent capabilities on the software side of the house, and also as a user of CRM, is that despite all those dollars, well intended as they may be, being spent on CRM, it is nonetheless still an operational system. It is one that is basically run by, fueled by human beings, and sales productivity is challenged with keeping up with this. You see that despite all these dollars being spent, still companies oftentimes are missing their forecast. You see, one of the things I've seen time and again, which is especially painful for field salespeople, is that they can lose up to basically a day a week, if not a little bit more, simply doing the basics of feeding the CRM system. And that's time spent doing data entry versus time spent doing selling. And that has, you know, perhaps not a direct, but probably not a coincidental negative impact on their ability to achieve success and achieve their quotas. Now, what I've seen, and I've again been on both sides of this, I've been a merchant of these arms in some cases. I've also been someone who's bought them for use in my companies. You'll see companies take all sorts of efforts to basically try and overcome these areas where they fall short. You'll see them basically kind of take, you might call it maybe a blunt force approach of trying to basically fix the rep behavior. They like to think that it has a lot of things to do with carrots and sticks. I've found while it may be carrots and sticks, it's a lot more stick than carrot in many cases. And so it's like, drive activities, track more. And again, that's the data entry challenge. And even if you get the most, you know, Boy Scout, Girl Scout, diligent sales teams out there to abide by that, they'll only share as much as they have to. And that oftentimes is not everything. And even what they do share is actually somewhat prone to their own biases and points of view on it. And so the data is inconsistent, the data is incomplete, the data is somewhat suspect. Now, a lot of times, if you're in that situation, and I've been in this many times, I used to spend a lot of money on like leads all the time. What you'll want to do is you'll want to overcome that pipe shortfall. You'll want to actually enrich or complement the data that's missing from your CRM by maybe buying some lead lists or doing some lead enrichment or contact enrichment. And the challenge with this is that data is often stale. That data is often incomplete. You often get redundant data. And what you're doing is, despite the best of intentions, oftentimes polluting your CRM with just more bad data, which then makes the following approach that a lot of companies take to try and solve this challenge even more of a difficulty, which is they'll say, hey, there's some this cool AI out there that I'd like to be able to take advantage of. Like, there's all these things that are about, like, you know, better forecasting productivity and you know, better, like, insights into who I should call next based on who has and hasn't emailed me in the past. And by the way, the concepts behind that are all tremendous. But where they start to fail, and we've talked about this in these sessions earlier today, you know, you heard Dan Jevons talk about this in a different context, you know, with respect to what they're doing at Shell. You know, you've heard other people talk about it here so far today. The AI is only as good as the data that's based on. And these bolt-on AI solutions are based on, again, if it's CRM data only, what you're gonna have is basically predictions that are gonna fall far short of the mark because it's an incomplete, inaccurate, human-biased view of what's actually going on. And so those bolt-on solutions are what I like to refer to as AI for CRM. Again, well-intentioned. In this case, though, what we're doing with C3 AI CRM is it's AI-enabled CRM. And what that means is we're trying to actually bring to you as a CRM user a CRM that does not replace what you've already built. It does not replace what you're already running on. So if you're running on Salesforce, that's great. Like, I mean, I worked at Salesforce for a number of years. It's a great product. And it's an operational CRM. If you want to actually capitalize on getting insights out of your CRM, you need more than CRM. You need a CRM of CRMs. You need other data, first-party data. You need other third-party data or exogenous data for a more comprehensive, less human-biased, complete picture of everything that actually can have an impact on your pipeline. And so that's our mindset with respect to what we're doing with C3 AI CRM. And the ability to actually then provide this holistic approach to AI is one that we believe actually puts our customers and users of C3 AI CRM in a better place to drive accountability and accuracy around those forecasts, again, that core foundational challenge. It gives them the ability to actually also increase their win rates. And more importantly, where time is truly money, which is out there selling every day, how can you maximize the time that every seller and every sales management person in the organization is spending focused on the right deals at the right point in the sales cycle with new prospects and existing customers? Now, as I said, C3 AI CRM does not replace your CRM. It actually sits right on top of it. And if you've got more CRMs, all the better. We can basically work with any and all of those as well. I think back on my time at Salesforce, working with great companies like GE, and they've got 7 different Salesforce orgs that they're running the company on. You know, this is there's reasons for doing that, you know, and they're all very good reasons. But again, it can cause some fragmentation and inability to get a consistent view of the pipeline for your company. What we've done here with this kind of, you know, again, with a C3 mindset on it for like an enterprise AI-driven approach is we've actually pre-built out the entire C3 AI CRM application. And what I mean by that is the user interface, the actual AI algorithms, the machine learning, if you will, all of the ETL, the not just the connectors, the data integration, the pipelines that feed the intelligence, all of this has been built out. And one of the key reasons for doing this is not only to deliver actionable insights that can actually drive rep behavior in a productive fashion, and to deliver insights that are based on a more comprehensive set of data, because it's not just your CRM that it consumes, as I mentioned earlier. It can consume everything that you have in first-party data sources, such as ERP, financials. It can consume data from your teams, your email, you know, and messaging networks and whatnot, so you can get a complete view of what's going on as you communicate between your people in your organization, not just sales, and also people in your customer base as well. Now, what we've also done is in terms of building out not only the UI and the machine learning and all of the actual data pipelines with this, is we've actually then productized this through various use cases, such as, and many of these you'll recognize, many of these you maybe are already doing or attempting to do on your own. Precision revenue forecasting, next best product or offer, price planning and optimization. And then also, of course, since we have a rich repository of experience building out industry-specific applications here at C3 in energy, in manufacturing, in banking, and elsewhere, what we're able to do is we're able to dip into the industry-specific elements of the C3 AI application data model to bring those to bear as well with C3 AI CRM. You know, as we do at C3, began working with customers. One of our customers in particular, we got very close with on this. It's a customer in the manufacturing space, and we wanted to really prove the theory out of that, if you will. So we basically sat down with them and said, listen, give us kind of 2 quarters. Give us your Q4 and Q1 of your particular, you know, kind of, in this case, it was like, I think this was like over a fiscal year ago. And that orange line basically is kind of their team's forecast, the human forecast, if you will. And it doesn't look that unusual. It's like you begin a quarter, there's not enough pipeline, people make more pipeline. You make more pipeline, forecast it up here, you go ahead and prosecute the quarter, and before you know it, we came in under. you start a new quarter, flush the pipe, go build more and like that. And basically, if you look at where they really kind of performed, that blue line, you can see the human forecast, you know, not unreasonably, maybe a bit more optimistic. But then actually when we took this and ran it through C3 AI CRM, what we did is we basically that green line plot much more closely along what the actual was. The net effect is this basically. If you look at their Q4 and they use Salesforce as their underlying CRM, this is where we first proved out the Salesforce integration, you know, their team was within 19%. And I mean, I'll confess, in my time, like, that's not bad. You know, I mean, I've seen better, but I've seen a lot worse. But we were within 4% when we applied C3 AI CRM. Similarly, their Q1, they were off by 16%, and then C3 AI CRM was off by 3%. So that's the kind of magnitude, basically, of improvement. And what's more, when we dug into, you know, kind of the data science underlying this, as I mentioned earlier, the way I refer to it is you want a CRM, or you need a CRM of CRMs to do this. You need data beyond just what's in the CRM app itself. And that you know, kind of multiplicity of data, particularly exogenous data sources, can really help drive much more precise forecasting. And, you know, now as we've been working with more customers, as we've been building, you know, all the models out, you know, there's over 2,000 features now, but at this time when we did this work, it was basically around 1,100 features that were part of the model. And, you know, of those 1,100, when we worked with this customer, 144 features were actually then selected for the model in their environment. And if you then look at basically the top most influential factors, the top contributing basically, you know, kind of features in the model, 7 of them were from basically those third party or external exogenous data sources, market and news related. Another was yet again an exogenous source. It was basically currency exchange basket information. And then one was CRM related, and it had to do with something that I think is, you could argue whether or not you even need AI for this, but it's basically where are you at with your bookings quarter to date. And so that was, you know, kind of for us kind of a key proof point. And it's one we're continuing to kind of live out, you know, basically over the last, you know, few months now, as we start to actually get more and more kind of traction with more and more of our customers, whether it's in manufacturing or energy or fintech or other industries. And it is again around not only these forecasting use cases now, but, you know, next best offer, you know, smarter kind of like, you know, total addressable market definition, customer segmentation, targeting and profiling, churn management, churn prevention, field service optimization, and those are other use cases. And as we work with these customers, we're seeing, you know, and they're seeing really some kind of, you know, very strong benefits, again, with respect to forecast accuracy, you know, almost, you know, like a 97% increase, or I should say 97%, you know, forecast accuracy. So much better accuracy on that front. We're seeing improvements in win rates, revenue growth, and other factors. And with that, we're not stopping. We got a lot more we're doing. And so, you know, really, basically, if you go back to, you know, kind of the, you know, late summer and the autumn time period, we've been really focused on a lot of what AJ showed you, which was basically let's generate not only AI scores, but as he really endeavored to do there in that demonstration, he spent a lot of time on what we call on the product team, the evidence package. I don't know if a salesperson would ever want to be confronted with an evidence package. They probably got other things they think that probably brings to mind. They're going to go to HR jail. But the idea that we've really invested a lot of time there in doing is let's make AI relatable. Let's make it intelligible. Let's make it intuitive. Let's make it actionable. While that may seem like one thing, to do that has taken a lot of honing. And so that explainability behind the AI scores so that you can actually, as both a manager, do much more prescriptive inspection of pipeline and then actually have the right kind of, you know, you're talking about the right thing in the right way. The rep doesn't need a big explanation because they can see it too. Those are the things we've really been focused on. And now what we're doing is, if you look at the period we're in right now, all the way through basically kind of like the middle to end of spring with our roadmap, we're focusing a lot more on the collaborative dimensions that impact forecasting. Now, if you look at the demo that AJ went through, one of the things you'll see is there's a pretty, you know, kind of like, you know, strict, you know, what I'll call hierarchy of how basically his sales team that he modeled that on was based off of. And it's a pretty common one. It's like basically you've got like, you know, rep A works for rep, you know, I'm gonna do it a different way. You've got like geographic rollouts. You've got a west, you got a central, you got an east. And you know, basically that's one dimension. But a lot of companies have industry dimensions. They have product line dimensions. They have top accounts. And so what we've been doing is we work with more of our customers now is they're saying we would like to be able to have, I wouldn't call it consensus forecasting, it's not that, but the ability for flexible hierarchies and roll-ups of the forecasts and the AI recommendations based on those dimensions. And then the other thing coming basically in late spring into summer is all of the AI, and if you've done some enterprise AI, I think you'll be able to appreciate this. While it is very powerful, It takes a certain amount of patience. I mean, C3 is very good at getting you there very rapidly. But what we also want to do is we want to increase and accelerate what you can do on your own to take yourself there. And what I mean by that is like self-service onboarding. I mean, CRM's done this now for the last like decade plus, where a sales ops person can go online, they can get themselves a trial, they can go through that trial, they can like set up users. And that's what we're doing with C3 AI CRM, where you can actually add your own users, configure your own forecast periodicities, manage those hierarchies, and actually do the mapping between the underlying objects in your Salesforce, your Dynamics, your Sugar CRM, whatever it is, and our schema on the C3 AI CRM side that feeds those data pipelines, that feed those AI recommendations that help power increased accuracy. We're happy to like make this as personalized as possible. Bring your questions, bring your use cases, and we can actually show you the mobile app in action as well for real. So thank you for your time, and if any of you got any questions, we're here.